Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for standing by. Welcome to the Data Protection and Breach Readiness How to Stay Secure webinar. During the presentation, all participants will be in a listen-only mode. Should you wish to ask a question during the presentation, please use the chat feature located in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. As a reminder, our conference is being recorded Tuesday, May 31st, 2016. Today's presenters are Neil Daswani, Chief of Information Security Officer at LifeLock, and Craig Spiesel, Online Trust Alliance. I'd now like to turn the call over to Neil and Craig for our presentation. Please go ahead.
Great, and good morning, and thank you. This is Craig Spiesel, and I want to thank everyone for the patience this morning and welcome Neil Daswani from LifeLock today. What I want to very quickly is go through here and share some information with you on who OTA is. For those of you who don't know, we are a nonprofit organization supported by about 100 organizations with the goal of developing prescriptive guidance to help businesses and all stakeholders to better enhance their data security and their privacy practices. So today we'll be sharing a lot of our research and findings in our data breach report for you, and look forward to discussion. Neil?
Thanks, Craig. So I'm Neil Twani from LifeLock. At LifeLock, our mission in life is to provide people a sense of confidence to live freely in an always connected world. We are a leading identity protection company and are pioneers in the space. We have over 4.3 million LifeLock members or customers who were committed to providing peace of mind given the threat of identity theft.
Great, Neil. Thank you. So just to provide a quick overview, what we're going to share here is the overview on the lessons learned from our 2016 data breach report that we re-released just 2 weeks ago, and really trying to drive and provide detail and context on what steps you can do to help prevent, what you can do to detect, and perhaps most importantly today, how can you better respond to that. And then towards the end, we're going to share some of the evolving threats and challenges, which I would like to suggest are becoming additional drivers of breach or data loss incidents. So the reality of incident response plans, we find a lot of experiences here. Personally, I've been involved with close to 75 different incidents over the past several years. And what we find that the plans are not fully tested quite often. The reality of the dynamics within an organization has changed. And so we see a lot of things. The threat landscape is very dynamic. And it's out of compliance sometimes with regulations. It is sometimes not in sync with what businesses are doing. And it hasn't been fully tested. And the reality is, it's always going to be a challenge, and so it's dynamic. So those are some of the realities, and so as a result of that, those were some of the drivers of us developing the plan and the resource guide. One of the reasons that OTA is so concerned is the mounting concerns of mistrust, and this mistrust is through multiple areas of privacy and security, and we're seeing a lot of threats and impact today on how it's affecting businesses. We're suggesting that we need to move beyond compliance. One of the biggest frustrations when I get involved in a breach and someone says, but we're XYZ compliant or we've been compliant with all the laws. And the reality is we need to move beyond that. And we believe that if as an industry and the business and public and private sectors, if we don't work together, we're going to really stifle growth. So these are some of the reasons why we're so concerned today. So what are the challenges, as I started to mention, is the threat landscape is constantly evolving. This is a very complex situation. Again, the scope of what is a data loss incident is changing dramatically. It's not just a forced breach from outside. Increasingly, we're seeing the number of internal incidents and such. So those are the challenges. At the same point, cyber criminals are less of what I would say, taking a position of a crime of opportunity, and they're being much more precise and focused. And we'll talk about that from the tactics, but also the companies and how, while you may not have consumer data, your company still may be at risk for other purposes. And the other two areas is the regulatory landscape. It's outside, it's beyond just the U.S., so we need to be taking a look at that. And just this morning, Neil and I were talking about some evolving regulations in some other areas of the world, including Australia, and obviously some updates that's happening in Europe. So again, we need to look not just where we have a physical nexus, but where your customers are. And the last point that Neil will have, I think, a great deal of context is what I call beyond your four walls. And as we continually are looking to outsource, to use cloud services, the role of security and privacy management is becoming increasingly complex and dynamic. And it's very hard if you don't have the pulse on what every group within your company is doing. So there's lots of data out there. I'm not going to spend too much time on this. But again, this is data of 2015 versus previous year. And again, there's no question the number of incidents increasing. But I think the most striking number on this slide and the biggest takeaway is what you could do to prevent the breaches today. And these are through typically operational issues, servers not being patched, user rights not being controlled in those areas. And we can talk about that later and follow up with questions. But whether it's our study here, there's a Verizon breach study, again, the majority of breaches could have been prevented. A lot of it comes down to employee controls, and these all drive why we have almost, according to the FTC, almost a 50% increase in consumers saying that they've been their identity's been compromised. So these are the challenges today, the realities, and it's not just PII, as I started to mention. We've seen cyber vandalism, hacktivism. We're seeing more social engineering exploits, and some of those are trying to drive ACH withdrawals in other areas there. So, again, it's not just your PII. In some cases, it's the actual bank account as well. So what do we need? What have we learned, I should say? I think the biggest thing that I've learned is that we need a shift of critical thinking of who is responsible. And to think that this is the role of the CISO or the chief privacy officer, I think will be really will posture you for failure. And it's where everyone within a company, with every group, needs to be focusing about it. As I mentioned yesterday, it's not about compliance. And again, many of our approaches yesterday may have been adequate, whether they're server configurations, but today they're inadequate. So those are areas we need to be really focusing here. And as we look at the realities, I think it's very important to recognize that every company has some type of covered information. But the most important part is the impact and the cost that I don't think companies typically recognize. And Neil, I'll welcome your feedback in a second here. But obviously, you know, we're most focused on the direct expenses, what it costs for bringing in forensics, what it's bringing in for law firms. But there's the other impact. And some of it's not your hard cost, but the impact your relationships or your brands. We've seen acquisitions go south in the result of this. So really, those are the issues. And the other part is that business shock and really how the interruption to your business and how this can paralyze everything, employees, it can impact recruiting in different areas. So those are, I think, the key areas that I think we sometimes underestimate. Cyber insurance can't necessarily cover you for those areas there. But Neil, I want to kind of turn it over to you and kind of, you know, from your perspective, you've been so involved in this area yourself.
Great. Thanks, Craig. You know, Craig, as you mentioned, you know, compliance does not guarantee security. Many organizations have to satisfy a whole variety of compliance standards, whether it's the PCI standard to take credit cards, whether it's the HIPAA standard for the medical field, you know, various ISO and NIST standards out there. But, you know, one interesting, you know, fact is that, you know, most organizations that have been compromised or have been breached, you know, they actually you know, pass their audits. So maybe one way to look at compliance is that you can look at compliance as, you know, a minimum bar for security. One other thing that I thought was a very good point that you made was that, you know, to just view security as the job of the chief information security officer or the job of the security team, you know, is probably not the right way to look at it, right? Being a steward of PII and important data is every employee's responsibility. Now, you can view the CISO and the security team, as a team that that can help be the shepherds and guides and the force multipliers for security across companies. But to steal from a Star Wars analogy, the Jedi's can help lead battles and such things, but they can't do it on their own. They need the army behind them. That's just building a little bit upon compliance. Craig, you had also talked about response planning. There's a couple different types of response planning. There's incident response planning. There's breach response planning. The two are, of course, related. But to put together a proper incident response plan, there's got to be a team empowered. There's got to be a designated set of first responders. There's got to be a notification tree so that as something goes from say being investigated as a potential event or a potential incident into an actual incident, there's a hierarchy of folks that get involved as necessary. One of the other things about an incident response plan is that it's definitely got to be something that's cross-organizational. It is while there might be one team or another team that first identifies something or leads some initial investigation, one thing that you should keep in mind when developing your incident response plan is to build a whole bunch of relationships and build all the appropriate cross-organizational muscle so that you can exercise it if and when needed, right? So relationships with law enforcement should actually be developed ahead of time. Relationships with the FBI, the Secret Service, as appropriate. The one thing that you probably don't want is a situation where the first time that they're hearing from you is when there's a potential breach. Rather, if there's relationships established ahead of time, the interactions and the speed at which one can respond is much faster. So in any case, there's a whole bunch of other things that one can keep in mind when doing incident response planning. I'll mention just a couple of them. Preserving evidence is very important when there is any sort of breach or potential breach. If you want to have any hope of, say, going after, let's say, an insider, or if you want to, go after somebody legally, there is a chain of custody that data needs to be preserved by, and it's important to establish the procedures for that ahead of time and make sure that people are trained. Because if there's one break in that chain of custody, then the evidence may not be able to be used in an actual case. If there's, one of the things that some communications and PR departments do is they create, communication templates for different breach scenarios and have a template pretty much ready to go. Now, every breach is a little bit different, but if you have a template that you can start with, then if there's ever a need that you need to use it, you can just customize the template as opposed to have to author and get communications approved from scratch. Training is an important part. Having your attorneys involved in driving various parts of the process are really important. Identity protection, of course, is also an important part of the game. If there is a breach situation that occurs and you need to protect your consumers, it's typically better if you have something pre-negotiated in place with one or more identity protection companies. Having cyber insurance is also important. So there's a lot of different components, as you can see, that come together. With regards to what can you prevent, what can you detect, what can you contain, what can you recover, I think that there's been a lot of thinking in the community that you can't just rely on prevention. It's important to do as many preventative things as you can, but having detection in place, containment in place, and recovery procedures in place is important. I guess one way to think about this is that you can't always predict when the hurricane is coming, but if you live in certain areas, you know that the hurricane is going to come. And so you want to have these wooden boards ready to go. You want to have your nails in places where you could find them. You want to have the tools ready to go so that at least you're prepared.
Yeah, Neil, this is
go ahead, Greg.
If I could just interject there, I think that was a great analogy. I want to just echo what you said. You know, the relationships with law enforcement. One of the things that you know, of building that relationship and sitting down, because they'll actually share with you what information they're looking for. They have some templates, and we have actually one in the guide that we reproduced. So you know what information they're going to need. And if you know what information you're going to need, it's going to force you to say, are we capturing that information? And the other part is you mentioned about forensics. The best time of having a relationship with a forensics firm is in advance, because they can do that pre-con, so to speak, identify issues on your network, become familiar with the network, look at your logs. So a lot of that in advance of the storm analogy that we're using, so when the storm does happen, they know how to respond. You don't want to have that meeting and then have to spend the half day walking through what your architecture is and finding logs weren't activated or collecting the right information. So that gets back into, you know, what you need to do in advance.
That's exactly right, Craig. In fact, one of the points that you made earlier is that you've got to practice all this. You know, in responding to any potential breach is a multifaceted sort of thing, and exercising, you know, not only how things work internally, not the different departments, but also, you know, reaching out to potential, you know, whether it be the forensics firm, whether it be the third-party law firm that you might use to help advise on communication, you know, all of that has to be exercised. You don't necessarily want the first exercise of it to be, you know, when the actual event occurs. You can imagine that an organization's response is going to be a lot more effective if there's some practice ahead of time.
Absolutely.
Good. So I was really glad to have the opportunity to work with Craig and the Online Trust Alliance on the 2016 Breach Readiness Guide. And we, in that guide, suggest a number of different security best practices. And, you know, there's more than a dozen or so of these. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but what I'm going to do is talk about a few of them. One of the ones that I'm going to talk about and place some focus on is encryption. You know, if you look at strategy, as we talked about, you want to, of course, do everything that you can to prevent a breach from taking place, but you also want to have detection, containment, and recovery measures in place. And, you know, one way to look at this is that, you know, if you look at banks, for instance, banks have, you know, for years known that, okay, burglars are going to be able to, you know, break in and get into the front door. They're going to hold a gun to the teller's head. They're going to tell the teller to give them the money, and they're going to make it out of the bank with some money. So what do the banks do? The banks basically give all the tellers sacks of cash to give to the burglars when they come in, but they do one thing differently. They put a canister of dye in there such that when the burglars make it out of the bank, they have that dye explode, and it makes all the money useless. And so one might look at that as a containment measure. Even though the attack occurred, you were able to contain the effects. One way to look at encryption is as a containment measure. So the idea is that even if the attackers are able to break in, what you want to do is, even if they're able to get in and they're able to get out, what you want to do is make sure that they don't get out with anything useful. And so if all of your most important data, if your crown jewels are encrypted with strong encryption, and there's a particular technical definition of what strong encryption means, but if they're encrypted with the right algorithms, with the right key lengths, and the keys are very well protected, meaning if the attackers are able to, you know, make it out with encrypted data, but not with the keys, you know, it's actually it actually does a lot to help protect the consumer's data, right? If the attacker's going to get out, make sure that they can only get out with garbled, encrypted stuff, and not any unencrypted stuff. And make sure that you protect those cryptographic keys. So data has to be protected, at rest and, you know, stored as well as in transit. But, you know, if you look at the different, and by the way, let me also just mention that up front that I am not a lawyer and this is not legal advice, but if you work together with your attorneys and look at the different you know, data breach laws in the different states, usually most of them will have a particular definition of what it means for there to be a breach. And in these various definitions, I mean, going back to the first one of these back in California in 2003, you know, it says, well, if there is unencrypted data that's stolen, right? And so in any case, I wanted to make sure that there's a just put a bit of emphasis here on the importance of doing strong encryption and strong key management. But let me go ahead and comment on a couple others of these, right? So a second security best practice is that, you know, your employees should be trained to not, you know, reuse passwords across different websites, and also not reuse those passwords in any of your corporate systems. In fact, just this morning, there was, you know, a set of quote-unquote historical breaches announced where there's a lot of things in the press about, you know, various companies having their credentials stolen, various web services, websites. And so you can imagine that when large amounts of credentials are stolen, attackers are going to want to see if, well, those stolen credentials, those stolen usernames and passwords might work on various corporate systems. So training your employees to you know, not reuse passwords is a very important practice. You know, and it depends on how far you want to go, right? You could imagine that from a technical perspective, you could also obtain those you know, those stolen credential sets and, you know, check or try to crack your own employees' passwords against all of those, right? So that's another example of going well beyond what most companies might do. I'll speak to, you know, point number four next. Whenever, if you're a company that builds and releases software, it's important for security to be taking place at multiple parts in the software development lifecycle. You know, if you catch a security problem at the design phase when things are on paper, then, you know, fixing it is a lot easier. If you find vulnerabilities later on, they're typically more expensive to fix, but at least you fix them. So the combination of doing the security design reviews and code reviews is important. And then, of course, once, you know, you're about to consider releasing something out the door, doing a penetration test and vulnerability scans also makes a lot of sense. Of course, you know, as we go along, the cost to fix increases, so the earlier that you can catch problems, the better. The last one that I want to speak to on this slide is authenticated mail. So if we look at how a lot of breaches have been taking place, phishing and malware are two very, very common threat vectors. On the phishing front, there's been a lot of recent scams where attackers have been sending emails asking for people's W-2s, and attackers are able to send in these mails because of some of the older email protocols on the internet, where anybody can send an email to anybody else claiming to be whoever they want to be. But over the years, there has been a lot of innovation and a lot of progress in the area of email security protocols. And so there's protocols like SPF and DKIM and DMARC, where just at a high level, an organization can digitally sign the emails that emanate out of the organization, and the public key for those signature checks can be published in DNS, so that when any email client or any other ISP or corporation receives those emails, they can check whether or not the email really came from any particular organization, any particular domain, and if there isn't a correct signature check, those emails can just be dropped on the floor so that phishers can't impersonate emails as easily. So in any case, those are some security practices. There's a few more that I can comment on, but Craig, do you have any particular thoughts that you want to chime in?
Yeah, you know, the email side is very important there, number six here, and as we're seeing that what's being called business email compromise as a whole category of abuses. And so there's two elements of this. It's one, how consumers are being spoofed and thinking that it's a legitimate mail from your company to reset your password or a login. So again, the impact there is on your outbound mail streams. If you're not taking a defensive strategy, you're really unnecessarily putting consumers at risk. So what we're saying here, and we actually have a report coming out in a few weeks, really about this really importance, and we're measuring that. So that's outbound to protect your consumers or business partners, and that's really about protecting, putting some simple things in place. The other side, the converse side, it gets back into the point that we made earlier about this increased precision. And so criminals are now not just sending out spam and seeing who's going to fall for it and get a keylogger. They're targeting very specific businesses. And so it's really becoming a business imperative that in your inbound mail to all of your employees that you be looking and see if the mails are spoofed and forged. So we highly encourage that. That is a best practice, and I think that you're going to see that moving forward in adoption in many areas there. So again, protect your consumers outbound, but also protect your inbound infrastructure from the malicious mails, whether that's spear phishing or ransomware or keyloggers and such.
Great. Thanks, Craig. So moving to the next slide on security best practices, and I'm just going to comment on a couple of these. Let's see here. Of course, when I'm having a little trouble clicking on the slide to go to the next.
Let me try here.
Yeah, it would be great. If you could go to slide 15. Thank you, Craig.
Well, I'm also having a problem here. Let's just see.
You're also having a problem. Okay, well, hopefully we have some technical folks on the line here that can help. But in the meantime, while they're working on advancing the slide, I'll speak to a couple other security best practices. You know, one of the other things that you can do is monitor in real time your external security posture, ranging from your web security, your SSL and TLS configurations, to a whole bunch of different areas. So, if, for instance, you earlier we were talking about the difference between compliance and security. And so, to be, for instance, PCI compliant, you have to use SSL, right, or TLS, right, to protect e-commerce transactions, make sure that the connection between the client and servers are encrypted, there's authentication of the server, and there's confidentiality. There can also be a difference between just using SSL or TLS and making sure that, well, you're getting an A grade when it comes to your SSL configuration. So you can be using SSL or TLS, but the configuration could be using old RC4 ciphers. The configuration could be vulnerable to Heartbleed or Poodle or a whole bunch of the different SSL vulnerabilities that have become prevalent over the years. And so using things like the various SSL scanners out there, whether it be the Qualys scanner or the high-tech bridge scanner, you can basically make sure that, well, you're not only complying, right, but you're getting an A grade for your configuration.
That's a really important point that we find is that things evolve, and so your SSL configuration it needs to be. I recommend people be testing that at least once a month. Simple tools; it takes about 5 minutes. You'll see some different flags on configuration. Sometimes your weak ciphers, protocol support, and unfortunately, this is a good example. Yesterday's approaches may no longer be relevant today. So that's a simple thing to be doing. And something we continually evaluate ourselves against.
Great, thanks, Craig. So I'll just flip to the next slide and speak to just a couple of these points. One point to consider is to consider using not just regular SSL certificates, but rather extended validation certificates, where your organization will have to prove more about its legal status as a business in order to get an extended validation cert. And typically, in most browsers, there's typically more green and better locks that can be visible to consumers. So given that we live in a day where certificate authorities can get compromised, and given that the more positive visual signals you can give consumers, considering these kinds of extended validation certificates are a good idea. You know, as we mentioned earlier, make sure that you're not only developing your incidents and breach response plans, but testing them and continually improving them based on what you learn in tests. And then finally, it's important for you know, every organization to have you know, a strong vulnerability management and vulnerability reporting program. The more that you can look at the different you know, threat intelligence feeds out there and you know, use them to inform the program, the better. But in any case, I think that wraps up you know, quite a few security best practices that you can put to use. Again, there's a lot more details in the breach readiness guide, so feel free to check that out.
Yeah, Neil, thanks a great deal. In that last point of vulnerability threat intelligent reporting, there's a working group that we're involved in with the Department of Commerce, NTIA, and that's really about vulnerability threat reporting and really about establishing what's the right way of doing it, the conduits, and some of the tactics, obviously, are bug bounty programs and such there. But I think it's extremely important that you as a company have a conduit, whether it's an email form, some type of program where a third party, whether it's a consumer or a researcher, can report to you. And I will tell you, as I mentioned, we're coming out with our annual online trust audit in 2 weeks, where we've assessed 1,000 sites. And it is very frustrating where we come across a vulnerability and we try to contact a company and we're unsuccessful. And that's increasing concern. I will tell you it's a concern by the SEC, it's a concern by the FCC and FTC. So from a regulatory standpoint, it's very important, but perhaps even more important from a plaintiff's lawsuit scenario, if you don't have a vehicle in place, there's increased scrutiny against that. So please have a vehicle, have a channel to be able to vet those out. That's something very, very important. So I'm going to move off of the best practices, if we can here, and you know, talk about, let's see here, there we go, some of the challenges. So we've been talking, Neil talked a great deal of getting a plan together, what some of the countermeasures, how you can prevent and having good security. There's no perfect security. But one of the other challenges, and this gets back into going through the post-mortem of a breach and having the challenges come up and not companies not having a good handle on what I call their data lifecycle practices and evaluating. And so one of the takeaways in this slide here, and the guide provides a lot more context here, is the need to have continual evaluation of what is your data strategy and what are you doing on how you acquire it? Are you providing consumers choice and control to opt out? How are you using it? And asking your questions. So what this slide is really to help you think about these questions. You know, how are you storing it? How are you using it? And then revalidating, is the business need that you established a year ago still valid? And the whole point here that we're trying to suggest is if you don't have the data, you can't lose it. So again, if you don't need it, or how can you anonymize it or retract some information? So a simple thing, for example, companies that want to send out birthday notices, do you really need to have the birth date of the year other than knowing someone's over a certain age? And so that's a small change some companies are doing and saying, okay, let's not have the full birth date. In fact, we don't even need to have the day. We can just have the month. You know. And so that's a good example of data minimization. A small element of it, again, going through this cycle is just a process here. The other part is, Neil touched on a little bit about communications, and I think one of the things here is in the chaos of fighting a breach of an incident, it's very chaotic at best. And one of the takeaways, it's not just a press release, it's having communications that are tailored for different audiences. Obviously, how do you respond to employees? What are your key partners? And so sometimes a key partner, you know, is better suited by having your CEO or someone in the executive team calling them up and calling them up before it hits the press. And then obviously how you respond to regulators, give them communication and other segments here. And then the point here is the tactics you approach, a phone call versus an email, the tone of the message, the timing, they're all really critical. And technology, I have that on here as a key point. There was a major breach that happened in a major retailer about 3 years ago, and they recognized they needed to send out email to over 5 million consumers. And they recognized that their servers didn't have the capacity to get them out. So someone provided another server that the address, the from address was at bfi01.com. And ultimately, those emails that went out to over 5 million consumers were all deemed to be, or most people thought they were phishing, because the email address was a very obscure address. Well, what it stood for was BFI was a company called Bigfoot Interactive that was acquired by some other technology providers. And so here's an example of a small little thing that created more angst and anxiety, and now they had to send out another mail on top of that. So be thinking about that. When you have to send out a very large sum of mails, whether it's 5 million or 10 million, you know, do you have things in place? And what we encourage is this actually come directly from your corporate domain. So if you were, you know, food, your company was food, it would be food.com versus a delegated subdomain that may be unknown or not as recognizable to the consumer. And again, using email authentication. So again, the message here is think about all the different parties. If you have investors, for example, how are you going to communicate to them? Again, because again, when they read about it in the paper isn't when you want them to hear about it. So that's a key takeaway is that I think, and developing those templates. And those templates, there was one company we were involved with, I was extremely impressed. They had a series of web pages ready to go. They were unpublished. And all they had to do was to make some small tweaks to those. And so, again, the time of trying to deal with these things in the middle of chaos, the more you can kind of have done in advance will really pay dividends in the back end. We talked about the regulatory landscape, very, very, very dynamic. And, you know, in the U.S. today, there's 47 state breach laws, different sectors, HIPAA, for example, and such have different requirements. The FCC, Federal Communication Commission, is now had an open comment period that ended last week about data breach notifications. So there's a tremendous amount of organizations and regulatory landscapes, and that's just in the U.S., and as we think about what's reasonable notice and how do you notice, and in some cases saying within 10 business days to consumers of upon discovery of an incident. So be thinking about that because ultimately you need to be in compliant with wherever you have a consumer residing. And Neil, I know you've kind of had some thoughts on this. Do you have anything you want to share on this slide? Or?
I think I'll just mention that you know, there's just given what's taken place over the past few years, I think it's important for you know, for organizations and for you know, for regulators to work together. You know, there's all kinds of hypotheses as to whether or not you know, self-regulation might be working, but I think that the only way that we're going to do the best thing for consumers is to do it together, together as a community.
Great, and I will tell you that from an OTA public policy perspective, we think both consumers and businesses would be better served with one national set of legislation. Provided that, you know, certain caveats that this isn't the bar should be set as stringent as the most stringent state. Otherwise, really don't see any benefit. And reality is most companies have to end up, they look at Massachusetts, they look at California in developing their strategy there. But we do think that businesses would be better suited, reduce the legal complexity, legal costs by having some federal legislation there. So, Neil mentioned about cyber insurance, and this is something we've been working on, and in the updated guide, response guide, we are fortunate to have some leading insurance companies that are now part of the alliance, and they've provided a lot of information here. But one of the challenges is I suggest that cyber insurance today is in its infancy. There is clearly a lack of standardization in terms of what coverage is for. And so you really need to do a very thoughtful review and specifically what is covered, what isn't. For example, do they cover costs of response, the forensics, public relation, breach notification? Do they cover for extortion or ransomware? There's a recent case that I learned that ransomware was not considered a breach because by the way it was defined. I'd suggest as we're seeing these forms of extortion that your coverage does include that. And the other area which was very concerned, the last point here, is willful negligence. There are at least two major insurance companies that are denying claims, and this is headed to court now, over willful negligence. And this is where an employee was spoofed and tricked into providing credentials externally, so it wasn't a breach. It was, you know, I sent a mail to Neil, and Neil gave me the credentials. So that's a different scenario. The other case was where an employee was tricked into doing an ACH transfer, again, a mail that was spoofed from her CEO. In this case, the perpetrator had gleaned information knowing that she was the executive assistant and had gleaned information about some personal things that she had posted on Facebook. So the mail was very relevant. It was forged and spoofed. And again, the employee did the transfer. So again, the points here is find out what's covered and what isn't and really push back and negotiate those to get clarification on what your coverage includes. Remedies is another big area there. And again, you know, quite often the state's saying that upon an incident, you need to provide identity theft monitoring to consumers. It doesn't really state more than that. And so how do you really structure this? And some of the things that I suggest, and then, Neil, I'd love your feedback. You know, I recently was over in Europe, and I actually did not have my password and was trying to contact an identity theft provider, which was not the LifeLock, but it was another company. And I was very frustrated because they were closed on weekends. And I had gotten a notification. So that was very frustrating to me. And so, you know, we believe that you should be asking for and see what the cost is for 24/7 support. Look at the relationship of caseworkers and help there. Also think about bilingual support. Obviously, what languages, but, you know, Spanish, for example, is increasingly the language spoken at home by a segment of the population. So should you be thinking about that? And then also thinking about, you know, others with maybe having visibility or hearing impairments, and how do you support them? So, Neil, do you have some thoughts on that?
Well, I do think it is very important to take, you know, these kinds of considerations in mind, because when the event occurs, you don't know what time of day it's going to be, and you know, it's just really important to you know, keep these various things in mind.
Sorry about that. So let's talk about some of the evolving threats real quick. I mentioned ransomware. And we have just a few minutes left here before Q&A, but I do want to touch on a few of them that you should be thinking about. We do have this information in the appendix of backup slides, in which you will get shortly there for a PDF will be sent. But three areas to be thinking about is to increase ransomware, and the point, the takeaway there is increased precision. It's no longer the drive-bys. It's being much more focused at companies. And again, not necessarily financial information, but recently we're seeing CPAs compromised, law firms compromised, engineering and architectural firms. And really, it's about encrypting and destroying or disclosing client data and how that can paralyze a company. Malvertising, again, is increasing of a threat vector. And Neil and I have worked on this issue for several years. But again, where the ads themselves are compromised and you visiting a trusted website, and just by that nature, the ads being served are actually trying to serve malicious code based on your device configuration and to exploit that. And the last one is IoT, and IoT is just very big right now as we think about the number of devices that are coming into our homes and the workforce. And towards that end, one of the things that we've been working on as a working group is to help address that. We've developed really 30 core criteria that are addressing this, the baseline security and privacy, and the third part is the sustainability or the whole life cycle and the patch management of these devices. So the key areas to be thinking about as, again, employees are bringing these devices into their workplace, how are you securing that? And if we think about, you know, the BYOD scenario that we all were looking at 5 to 8 years ago, I'd suggest that IoT is just creating that up, ratcheting that up another level. So as I mentioned, Neil and I have mentioned the report here, the guide. It's a free guide that we have available. You don't have to register for it. You just download. There's a lot of appendices in here. As I mentioned, cyber insurance is a key area. We have an appendix for incident reporting, as well as considerations for remediation and risk assessment. So these are all available out there. We continually update, so we certainly always welcome feedback in here in the report. But again, it's towards our goal to help businesses better review here. So in summary, I just want to really hit these points here, and then we'll take some questions real quick here. Again, and Neil, you talked about this, about create this security and privacy aware culture within an organization. You can't do it alone, and you need to get buy-in. The second point, and I talked about it in that earlier point about your data and your data lifecycle, is do you still have a legitimate business purpose on any data collected, and how long do you hold it for? Neil did a great job walking through those security best practices. If you're not following them, I think what I'd suggest you need to better be able to justify why not. Creating a team, again, a plan of first responders, communications, and the last few things about the cyber insurance coverage, your communications, and I think test, and revise and learn from that. So that's a summary there, and we do have a few minutes for Q&A, so I'll kind of turn it back to the moderator.
Hey, this is Jennifer Lewinsky, the Editor-in-Chief here at RSA Conference, and I will be reading you the questions from the audience here. The first one we have is asking about the increase in incidents. Is it that there are more incidents, or have we just developed better tools to identify security incidents? They'd like to get your view on that.
Well, that's a really insightful question. I think it's a combination of both. I think there's I add a third element. I think we have better tools to be able to monitor and detect intrusions or attempted intrusions. We also are, I think businesses are becoming more self-aware of the need to report on there. So I think we have that. And I think clearly there's continued press coverage. That would be my assessment. But at the same time, I do think we're seeing more targeted, a good example, the ransomware. That's a whole new tactic going after new segments. The malvertising, the number of incidents that are driving. So we see the criminals being more precise. That's my view on it. Neil, what perspectives?
Sure. Well, I think the first law around this came out in 2003 in California, where companies were required to notify when there were such incidents and breaches. Prior to that, one didn't hear much. So I think that, you know, it's exactly right that it's a combination of both better laws, but also more monitoring and more detection. You know, I will also mention though that, you know, some organizations get notified of a breach, basically when the FBI or the Secret Service tell them. So I think, you know, there's still advancements that need to be made there, but it is indeed a combination of both.
Great. The next question. When it comes to the encryption of data at rest, what is the risk that you're trying to mitigate?
Sure. This is Neil. I can take that one. So, you know, there are a whole bunch of, for instance, compliance standards that require data to be encrypted at rest, right? And certainly if data is encrypted at rest on a hard disk, it does protect against, for instance, you know, somebody walking out of a data center with a disk that has sensitive data on it. But recently there's been a lot of breaches where, for instance, you know, the attacker, you know, gets the database administrator's password through a phishing attack. And, you know, even if one has, say, encrypted data at rest at the file level, it doesn't protect against an application layer attack like that, where the DBA, when the DBA's credential is used to pose a query against the database, it just gives back all the data in the clear. Rather, if you do encryption at rest at the application level, then even the DBA won't be able to see the unencrypted data. Even if the database administrator poses a query. Rather, if you can organize your service such that only in production automated accounts are able to access the keys that decrypt data, you then are able to protect against a much broader scope of attacks.
Fantastic. It looks like we have time for one more question. Can you expand on the completing risk assessments for service and cloud providers?
Yeah, I'll take a stab at that. It's this is a challenge as we all see the benefits, the cost, the economies, the scale, scalability of using hosted solutions. What the challenges is you need to do an assessment of not only their security practices, but also the privacy practices. Is there some data sharing that's going on? And then the other element is, what do they designate as a breach or an incident? And how do they define it? And one of the big areas there is that I've found quite often their definitions may not be aligned with your own company. So you need to really look at all those things, the security aspects of it, the privacy practices, how do they designate a breach or a data incident, and then when do they notify you? And so that's really important, and the challenge is increasingly you have perhaps HR may have certain providers, marketing may have different groups within your company may have different providers. What are their relationships and what are their notifications? Even your PR agency, what are their notifications? So that's something you need to look at. Anyone who's handing classified or confidential information as well as consumer information. Neil, how about from your side?
I think you covered the key points there, Craig.
Great.
Great. Other than that, you know, I wanted to to let folks know that I'm available on Twitter. You can feel free to, you know, contact me at Neil Daswani. You know, LifeLock's happy to be there for its members 24/7.
Great. Thanks, Neil. And again, the information here, you can contact me myself as well. The breach guide you can download. And as I mentioned, on June 14th, we will be releasing our annual audit. And it's an audit of 1,000 consumer-facing sites in the banking sector, consumer services, e-commerce, news and media sites, as well as federal government sites. And this audit really looks at over 50 data points on a composite weighted analysis on data and site security, consumer protection, and privacy. And stay tuned to see who will be making the honor roll this year again. But our goal is to recognize best practices, and many of those that Neil covered here are actually part of the criteria. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Neil and Craig, for an excellent presentation. Thank you all for joining us for this RSA Conference webcast. Our next webcast, also with Online Trust Alliance, is June 30th. Please check the RSA Conference website for details. Thanks, everyone. You may now disconnect.